Hi everyone, it's Braylin and welcome back. So if you follow me on Instagram, then you know that I've been on this journey for the past couple of months, really talking about literacy instruction within special education. And it has taken me down this weird rabbit hole of me trying to understand and figure out reading instruction, how are we doing right by kids, and what have I been missing over the past couple years when it comes to me teaching reading. Now, I don't know if you guys are either student teachers or veteran teachers, or you're like me and you're somewhere in the middle, but from what I've seen in the classroom, by how I've acted and taught and how other people have, there are some big gaps when it comes to literacy instruction. Just a little bit of background about me. I went to two really awesome schools for education. I went to Wheelock College, which is in Boston, and I went to the University of Illinois, which is in Champaign-Urbana, Illinois. And both of them talked a lot about special education, did a lot of research. I mean, I was on some really cool teams. But when it came to my coursework, I counted it out and I only really had three classes related to literacy. Only three. And honestly, when I tell you the titles of them, you're gonna be like, oh my gosh, you really learned nothing. Because one of the classes was called Teaching Reading, which was great, but it was special ed and general ed combined. And all we really talked about was like how to do small groups and different activities to create, to talk about phonics and different things. And it was great, but it was a semester long. And really, I just learned how to create activities. I did take a class in special ed about reading assessment, and that entire class was dedicated to assessing and taking data, which if you're in special ed, I'm not going to go too much into taking data because we know data is important. But that class taught me how to identify a disability, how to identify a reading level, but it didn't talk about the interventions that I needed to access that. And the last class I took was also a general ed class, and it was fiction and nonfiction. And it was great because it talked about passages and how you can break them down, and I needed that. But when thinking about special ed, what we're focused on is the day-to-day small, tiny details that lead us to teaching reading. Learning how to read, right? Not how to break down a passage yet. Over on Instagram, I asked a lot of my followers about the classes that they took and how many classes they took and whether it was effective. And I want to say that I got over 500 responses. And I want to tell you a little bit about just the overall like statistics of what I gathered from people. Everybody that answered was either a special ed teacher or a general ed teacher. And when I asked about the classes that they took related to reading and teaching reading, so I had 74% of people said they took two classes in college related to teaching reading. A smaller group of 21% of the people said they only took one class, which is still kind of shocking. And then there was about 4% to 6% of the people that said they took three or more classes, which was awesome. But there was a whole mixed bag. Some people said it was super helpful, they felt really prepared. Some people said that they didn't. And I'll tell you that for me, I didn't feel prepared to teach reading until I went and got a different certification and took some free classes when it came to reading acquisition. Just overall, I felt super unprepared. So I want to talk a little bit briefly about some of the challenges in the classroom and some of the common things that at least special ed teachers like me see in the classroom. And if that resonates with you, let me know. Hopefully something in this resonates with you guys. So for me, the most common thing that I see is a lot of students in the younger years still working on phonemic awareness and understanding, honestly, the alphabet, honestly, understanding print concepts. They're still working at that basic level. And when we write IEP goals, we're writing them about what they need in the moment. At least for me, as an early childhood teacher, I'm working on, you know, letters, letter sounds, basic blends, and those things are so important. They're the building blocks of language. A lot of times what I see when kids are about to be, you know, third, fourth, fifth grade, they're still in special ed, they still do not understand any level of phonemic awareness or even alphabets, we make sure that they at least can memorize everything, and then we move on to sight words. So we immediately move on to the next step. I read an incredible book, which I highly, highly recommend. It's called Comprehensive Literacy for All, and it basically breaks down the notion that kids can't read. It basically is telling everyone that even if a child is in high school and they have a severe disability, they still can read and they still can learn to read, and we should not give up on them. And I say that because that is a huge thing of what I've been seeing recently. And this channel is a place for me to share all the thoughts that I have, to share the things I'm learning about. And the biggest thing that I'm learning about is that once we reach a certain age, we start to give up on kids and their ability to understand reading. So I've been thinking about this, and I've been thinking about what it means for me. And I don't want to tell you what to do. I'm talking about me and what I understand. Going forward, based off of all of this, I've been thinking a lot about how much more I need to emphasize phonemic awareness. I am going to take that very seriously this year, whether it's distance or in person. Talking about phonemic awareness, working on those skills and not moving past them for the sake of time. Usually there's like a hierarchy, you know, you start with your alphabet, then you move on to some phonics, you move on to some phonemes, you move on to some digraphs, you move on to some blends, and then you start to put words together. At the same time, you're working on sight words that kids just cannot sound out. And those are the steps that I think we all know how to take. When it comes to data, I also think this is very key. I can't move on unless I know the data that they have. And I've been thinking about this a lot when it comes to students. I'm gonna be taking pretty intense data this year. I have in the past, but it's only gonna ramp up more. Data on what they're understanding that week, and that will inform what I do next week. A big thing I want to note is that in an IEP, say a kid is starting to understand to blend, and I move on to a different IEP goal, I still am going to be working on their previous IEP goal as well. I'm still going to be reinforcing blends. I'm still going to be using them again and again, because as soon as we finish one IEP goal, it doesn't mean that it's cut off. We're still doing maintenance. We're still continuing it and trying to improve that craft. I want to recommend a few resources for you. There's one incredible article that came out of Vanderbilt that has 10 like tips when it comes to teaching reading in special ed. I'm going to give them all the credit and I'm going to link them down below, but I want to read the tips. I'm going to read them right from my computer of the things that they emphasize and say are the most important, and I hope it helps you. So the first section of it is talking about focusing on instructional planning. And the big key takeaways of that is keeping the big picture in mind and ensuring that you have a clear picture of the student's current level of performance. That goes back to that data piece. So you're aware of the big picture. Okay, this kid is in fourth grade and we're working on being able to read so that it can help them in their life skills, their social skills, all of that stuff. And I have taken adequate data to understand where they're at currently. The next section is focusing on instructional delivery, like providing explicit instruction. If you've taken data and you know that that kid is confusing certain consonants and they're not there yet, we are explicitly teaching consonants. That takes more work because that might mean you have to plan for your staff to do it. That means you have to make sure you have the right manipulatives, the right activities to do it. Again, don't buy them, make them, do your research, use Pinterest, think about it, but explicit instruction. Working off of that, we wanna make sure we're including working memory. We're scaffolding with that. Using more things, images, real live images, objects if you can, different letters, incorporating words, incorporating movement, anything to try and get this thing to stick. Another layer of this is using your scope and sequence to reinforce your skills. So yes, you're working on explicit instruction when it comes to reading, but throughout the day, you're doing read alouds, you're talking with kids in science and social studies, they're going to different classes for inclusion. All of those things have a sequence in mind, and you can reinforce all of those skills throughout the day, being mindful of that, taking time to train your staff in that. Again, going back to that data piece, using the data again and again, You do something, you take data on it, you try it again. I wouldn't necessarily give up 100% on an intervention until you've seen it through for a week or two. This is why special ed takes so much longer, because we're doing interventions, we're seeing if they work, we're going at a slower pace, and that's totally okay. That's why we make a goal for an entire year, because we know that we need that time to really build up a program, to really help a child, and it's all right if it's going slowly. Because if you're going slowly and you're working on the skills and you're doing it explicitly, I think it's probably gonna stick a little bit better than going fast through, seeing that an intervention doesn't work, scrapping it the next day and going to a new one that's too confusing, and it's not gonna get you anywhere. Also, I would say the last piece of this says involve service providers, involve family members, involve the fellow teachers, all of the staff into what you're doing. You need to take the time, and I've been trying to do this, to write out what each kid's strengths are, making sure that I share that with the staff, making sure they know the goals that they're working on. If you have any type of consult meeting, getting together, you know, this kid's really, he's almost getting it. He's getting to be right there. Maybe the speech can reinforce that. The OT can reinforce that. Letting the teachers know in the classroom. Obviously, don't overwhelm them. They have their own goals. They have their own things they're working on. But goals are never completed in isolation. They're only completed when they're in the right context of real life. And so it's hard to work on one reading goal when it's not within the context of the rest of the things that that child is doing. I also want to share another piece of information and a resource, which is an incredible, incredible place. So it's the Florida Center for Reading Research. I'm going to leave the link down below. It provides so many free activities and free things based on the kids' levels, for reading acquisition and all that stuff. And I say, go for it. If you can find free resources, free interventions, why not? I already kind of hit on this point, but I want to say it again, which is that IEP goals are not accomplished in isolation. In special ed, we have our independent workstations, which are great because kids need to be independent. Keep those up. We have our small group stations. Great, we need that because that's when that nitty-gritty teaching is happening. We also have our whole group, which is really fun and cool because we can reinforce a lot of things. But you put all of those together and that's where the skill is going to be acquired. As I've been doing my research, I've been thinking about it like this. When it comes to math, okay, we teach addition, then we move on to multiplication. We would never teach multiplication first before we completed addition. Sometimes kids don't get all of the skills in math and we do move on, but we move on enough that those skills they didn't acquire will be seen again in the next level. They'll get another opportunity to test that out and to try it and to master it. I'm sharing all of this not as a person who has mastered this, but as a person who's been looking really, really closely at a lot of these things and is trying so hard to make sense of it and to figure out how I can be better as a teacher going forward. I've been following recently a lot of really, really cool reading specialists and different people on Instagram because I've been really wanting to learn from them. And I've gained a couple pieces of, you know, cool information that I think might help you guys. When I would teach reading, I would teach like decoding a word and blending it back together, and I would make the sounds in isolation. So for example, the word smash, I would have kids eventually get to the point where they go smash, smash. But having those sounds in isolation is really hard for a brain to then combine them. And one of the coolest things I've been learning from these cool reading specialists is to do continuous blending. So instead of doing smash, emphasizing it and almost like elongating the sound, so smash, smash, and so to make it like elongated instead of chunking it up. Also, I've been realizing that less is more. Having a manipulative, having one letter and two objects will go so much farther than having five different worksheets and different things. I think the last piece of advice that I've been realizing for myself and from these reading specialists, and it kind of goes back to like IEPs, because I feel like everything goes back to IEPs, is making sure that my goals are really good and really measurable. putting it into practice, that I have tons of data to back up my stuff, even if it means I've never written a goal like that before, because it's that specific and measurable for a kid with really awesome objectives. I'm gonna take the time to do that. And I'm gonna take the time to talk to other people and to research it. I think the last thing is that teaching is so fun because it's an art form. And I think it's cool to be able to gather all this cool information and materials in different places and put them together and like craft something so beautiful. I hope that something in this video was helpful. These are just all my thoughts dumped right onto you. But I'm gonna link all of the information below, and I hope that you take something away from this and reevaluate some of your reading instruction and your IEP goals to make this year, whether it's distance or in person, the best reading year yet. And please don't give up on kids even when they get a bit older. They can still learn to read, they can still do it, and they can still be successful. You guys are awesome. I'm so grateful for you, and I'll see you in the next video.